Hi, my name's Chef Robert Sevely, and welcome back to Flavor of Riverside. Today, we're doing pies. So it's autumn, and what's more American than pie is what I say. Not just apple pie, but all kinds of pies. We're gonna be doing four different kinds of pies for you today. We're gonna be doing apple, we're gonna do a chocolate pecan pie, we're gonna do a mixed berry, which will have blueberries, blackberries, and raspberries. And then we're gonna do a chicken pot pie. So I hope you enjoy, stay with me, and we'll cook up some pies. Okay, there are many different types of and styles of pie dishes out there. I have a few on the counter here. Of course, you have the metal, type pie dish. They're very thin. You have to kind of watch the cooking time with it, especially when you're doing your own pie doughs. The pie doughs that you buy in the grocery store that are already in the tins, they're kind of set up for the tin. They're not necessarily using real butter and stuff like that, even though there might be a portion of real butter. So just realize that. I'm sure that the pie dough that I'm going to give you today would work in these. But probably most of you guys have something similar to these three. Okay, the Pyrex is very common, so you can utilize that, and that's a 9-inch dish. Then you have the porcelain or ceramic type style dishes that they're enameled front and back, and this is also a 9-inch. The ones that I prefer are, they're generally made by like companies like Le Creuset or something like that. And this is a 10-inch deep pie dish. You can also do like deep dish pizzas in these and different types of tarts or quiches or something like that as well. So these are the pie dishes that I really prefer. So let's get these out of the way. And then we're gonna talk about different tools you need in order to make pies. I want a good surface in order to roll out my pie dough on. I want to make sure that I'm not rolling out on something that has grooves or that's a tile. And I have a good, nice cutting board here. Then I want a decent rolling pin. They make rolling pins in all different shapes and sizes. This one's big. You don't have to go with something this big. But try not to go with some sort of mason jar or something like that. This one has handles. Some of them don't. Some of them you'll roll them like this, but this one, we have actual handles on it. So then the other things that I need is I need a dough cutter. So this is basically to cut the butter into the flour itself. And so it's called a dough cutter. It has five different ribs on it. And this will just break up the butter right into the dough or the shortening. Then I have a nice big bowl. And you'll notice, I already have the flour in here, but you'll notice with the dough cutter, it goes right along the inside of this bowl. So I have a nice rounded bowl itself along with the dough cutter. Then I need a fork. And the fork is to help stir once I start adding water. Outside of that, if you have these things in your house, in your kitchen already, then you're ready to make pie dough. Now, what about the ingredients? So I have the flour. Next, I have some sugar. And you can use sugar or not. This is just to help make your pie dish a little bit sweet. A little bit of sugar. Then I have a little bit of salt. You know, I'm a big advocate of kosher salt. But for this, I want to use fine salt. It can still be some sort of sea salt or something, but that Morton's like table salt is really what you want. So I'm gonna add the salt in. Then I have the butter. And so this can also be shortening. It can be, you know, even lard or something like that. For this recipe, you can just substitute, but we're using butter. Make sure that you use a high quality butter. Believe it or not, a lot of butters have quite a bit of water in them. So the lower the quality of butter, the more water it has. The higher quality, the more butter fat it is. And so the water in the butter will actually affect the pie dough. So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to stir all the dried ingredients together. And then I'm going to go ahead and add the butter. The butter needs to be really cold. Really important that it's really cold. So if you're using something else, a shortening or something, it also needs to be really cold. So I pulled that out of the refrigerator a minute or two before we came on camera. So I'll just sort of have that in there. Let's talk about a couple other things that we need. Let's get this stuff out of our way. I need bench flour. The bench flour is flour that I'm actually gonna put on my work surface or bench, okay? So here's our bench flour. So that just gets set up to the side. And then I need ice water. So just water, as much ice as you can get in there. And I sort of eyeball this all together. The salt, the sugar, the butter, the flour is all pre-measured. The water, I go ahead and I add it as I kind of need it. I go with a lot in the beginning and more as I kind of mix together. So let's start mixing. I'm going to take the dough cutter along the side of the bowl and I'm going to go down through it. Go down through the butter and the flour, cutting as I go. Try not to get too messy. Try not to flip flour out of the back of the bowl itself. So I just turn and spin as we go. What I'm looking for is I want it to be the consistency of like cornmeal with like peas in it, okay? So the majority of the butter will be kind of directly mixed into the dough with little pea-sized shapes kind of floating around in it. This doesn't take long. You can see I'm cutting in one spot, moving the bowl. All right. We want to knock the butter off the cutter once in a while. Give it another toss. One more run through here. And that's good to go. So this is what I'm looking for. Is you can see here, looks like cornmeal, and it has these pea-sized pieces of butter along in it. What's gonna happen with that? What makes a flaky pie dough, you'll see as I start to roll this out, it'll be these little pieces of butter kind of fleck through there. That will melt away, I'll leave a pocket, and that makes it for a flaky pie dough. So now, I'm gonna grab my fork, my ice water, and I'm gonna go right into the center. That's right at about half a cup to 3/4 of a cup. And then just using the fork, I'm gonna bring it together. And this will sort of tell me how wet it is without mixing it too much. Remember, you mix pie dough too much and you're gonna end up with tough pie dough. So we wanna mix it just as little as possible, just enough to kind of bring it together. So I still need more water. And that's probably gonna be good there. So still utilizing the fork, making sure I have it as mixed as I can before I get my hands into it. Okay, remove anything off the fork, set my water aside. Now I'll utilize my hands and I'm just gonna bring it together. And kind of shape it somewhat into a log. All right, so now I have it into this section. That looks good. You can see it's still nice and flaky. It's not just one solid mass. You can see how it will kind of flake apart. This is exactly what we want. So now we'll cut this into threes and we'll start rolling out the pie dough. We'll be right back.
My name Welcome to my shop. We're probably the best mechanics in the city, but every good mechanic knows it's important to recycle used oil. If you change your own oil, make sure to drop it off at the nearest used oil collection center or one of the city's household hazardous waste events. Or you can always come down to Val's and I'll take care of it for you.
Okay, so we've just gotten done mixing the dough. And what I like to do is now I'll cut it into threes. By the way, this is the same dough that we're going to be using for all of the pies today. So how I'm going to just cut the dough is I'm just going to take a knife. I'm going to get in here and I'm just going to pull off sections. So I have, off of that recipe, I'm going to get three different sections for pie. So pie bottom, pie topper, another pie bottom. I'm gonna go ahead and put the rest of these back into the fridge as we let these rest and as we go on. I'll show you here in a second. So now I'm gonna get my bench flour out and I'm going to flour the surface of my cutting board pretty heavily, I might add. Then I'm gonna take my dough and press it down into like a disc. And then I'm gonna flour the top of it. Don't need to really flour the rolling pin. So now I'm gonna try to roll this out as round as possible. I'm not always real successful at this. It does take some practice. I wanna make sure that the pie dough keeps moving, that it doesn't attach itself to the cutting board. If it starts to, we can lift it up and throw down some more flour, okay? So, once we get it to this point, like so, we're gonna want to get our pie dish. Here's our pie dish. I'm gonna get a little bit of butter and I'm gonna butter the pie dish itself. And so you can use some sort of like aerosol for this if you would like. That's fine too. I'm gonna even butter the rim really well. And then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna pick this up with the rolling pin itself. So I'll come all the way to the front. Just kind of slightly removing the flour as I go. You can use a brush on that if you want, but I just sort of pick it up like so, bring over my pie dish, and then I'm gonna lay it back into the pie like that. Then I'm gonna lift and tuck. And if it needs like more on one side, that's fine. It's very hot in the studio today, so I'm having to work fast. All right, once I get it to this point, I can trim it, but this is when I like to let the pie dough rest. So I'm gonna go ahead and take this and I'm gonna put it back in the fridge. All right, now we're gonna mix the apples. Today, I'm using Granny Smith apples. So the other varieties of apples that you can use is like Macintosh or Pink Ladies. You can find those in the grocery store. But you can also use Beverly Hills, which is a locally grown apple that's really great. And I'm all about, like, I like to call it, instead of farm to table, garden to table. And I know lots of friends that have apple trees. So first, we want to deal with our apples. So the best way that I know how to deal with them is I'm going to use a peeler and a cutter. And obviously, if you're doing your apples ahead of time, you're going to want some lemon juice. So first, what I'm going to do is I'm going to peel the apple. And I'm just going to quickly kind of roll through the apple, pulling off the skin. Apple pies with skin on them are not very much fun. So, once I get it to this point, I'm going to trim the top of the skin, and I'm going to trim the bottom. And then, just real simple, I'm going to stand the apple up and put the stem right through the center hole. This is cutting 8 pieces here. And then I'm going to go straight down and through the apple. I'll pull the core out, and then I just pick the whole thing up and move it over to there. And I'm done. So we have cored, peeled, ready to go apples. All right, so now I'll set this stuff aside. And we're gonna mix. So first thing is we need a couple cups of brown sugar. This is some flour and sugar, regular white sugar that I'll show you all about. We need some molasses, which I have pre-measured out here. We have some flecks of butter. We have our cinnamon, nutmeg, and clove. You can use allspice, you can use mace, you can use even like a nice pumpkin pie seasoning is really great on apple pie. And I'm sure that there's some apple pie spices out there that you can find and buy too. And then I need just some regular flour as well. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go in here with my brown sugar. I'm gonna go in here with my molasses. I'm gonna get my hands dirty, so, because I gotta mix this with my hands. I'm gonna get this all into there. Then I'm gonna go in with my spices. So all that goes in. And then I have my little bit of flour. So let me give you a quick little history on apple pie. Apple pie is derived from the recipe tarte tatin, which is a French recipe to where the apples are done in a skillet with butter and some sugar and stuff like that, and they're caramelized. And then they put pastry over the top of the cast iron pan and bake it. And then they turn it out onto a pan. That is the predecessor to American apple pie. So for us though, we're sealing it with pastry top and bottom. This is classical. This is my grandmother's recipe from the Sevely side of the family. This is her recipe. And so I'm doing it the way that she taught me how to do it. And one of the things that always happens a lot of times with apple pies is you end up with a lot of liquid. And one of the ways to adjust for that liquid is to add some flour to it. And so that's what I'm going to start off by doing. So I'm going to give this a toss, and then I'm going to sprinkle in some flour. So this all gets tossed together. The other thing that you don't want to do is mix this too early. If you mix it too early, the sugar will start to draw the moisture out of the apples themselves. And so just kind of get this tossed, kind of like you're tossing a salad with your hands. And I want to utilize my hands instead of something else because I want to make sure that that sugar's coating evenly, and I want to make sure that the molasses is coating evenly. Then we're going to pick up the flour, and we're going to just sprinkle the apples. And what I want is just a nice coating of flour on all these apples. A little bit more. Just like so. That looks beautiful. Let me wash my hands. We'll get back out the pie crust. We'll fill our pie. We're gonna make our topper for the pie, and then we're gonna get it baking. So I'll be right back. Okay, now we're gonna get out the pie dough. And so, pull out the pie crust that we just rolled out. It's chilled and it's relaxed. And so now, I'm gonna go ahead, I'm gonna add my apples to the pie crust itself. Sometimes it takes them all, sometimes it doesn't. The recipe calls for 12 apples. With this, you know, it depends on the size of the apples, obviously. I want a nice big mound of apples, but nothing too huge. I don't want to go too crazy. And then I want to make sure that I add any of like the little bit of syrup that's sort of collected at the bottom. So I think that's good. I'm gonna set that bowl aside. And then I'm gonna set this whole pie aside and we're gonna roll out. First though, let me add the flecks of butter. So we have butter along the sides. Like so. And this is just to help kind of with moistness and some caramelization and all that good stuff for the apples themselves. Then, one of the little tricks that my grandmother taught me was you take a flour and sugar mixture and you sprinkle the top of the pie with that. As this cooks, this runs down through the apples and collects all the juice and makes this really nice caramel on the bottom. So, I'm gonna set that aside. I'm gonna set the pie aside. And we're gonna roll out our topper. I'm gonna pull out another section of my dough. I'm gonna grab my bench flour and get a healthy portion of flour onto the cutting board along with the top of the dough and my rolling pin, and I'm gonna roll this out. Now, it's so hot in the studio today that we have to be fast. Now, this doesn't have to be huge, but it really helps for it to be round. So, you can do different things with the pie toppers. Is these are like giant cookie cutters, and you can lay these on here and you can cut out the shapes. And so this is an option. We're gonna utilize these a little later and just show you all kinds of different little techniques and stuff. So what I'm gonna do now, just like I did before, I'm gonna pull the dough up onto my rolling pin. Move that out of my way, bring my pie over. At this point, if I have any excess around the outside, like too much, I wanna leave right about a good solid inch, inch and a half, hanging off the sides if I can, because that's gonna help our crust. All right, so that looks good. We just get rid of these. Then we're gonna take egg wash, and we're gonna egg wash the whole outside rim of the pie itself. Then, we're gonna make sure our apples are all nice and tucked in. Then we're gonna take our topper, and we're gonna go across the top here. Just like so. Beautiful. Cut off any excess again. And then, let me get this stuff out of the way. Pull my pie up. Get myself cleaned up just ever so slightly. Okay, now bring the pie back over. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna lift and tuck. Lift and tuck. I'm kind of twisting everything under. All the way around. This is gonna help seal the pie. That way, when the pie bakes, the juices from the apples don't come out the sides. And then our next sealing step is we're gonna go one finger on the inside and two on the out, and we're gonna pinch together. So then, we're just coming along and fluting the outside of the pie itself. Like so. Then I want to cut a little star in the top, and that's to vent it. I make sure that I don't have any air pockets in the top of the crust once I vent it. And then I'm going to egg wash all the way around. Once I get it all egg washed, I egg wash the whole thing, we'll get it into the oven, and we'll come out with homemade all-American grandma's apple pie. I hope you guys really enjoy this recipe. After it's baked, we'll give it a cut, and I just want you to really enjoy grandma's all-American homemade apple pie. We'll see you guys in a little bit. Okay, the next pie that we're gonna do is gonna be a chicken pot pie. And so I'm gonna make the filling first. We're gonna do these chicken pot pies right in like almost like a nice soup bowl or something like that. It could be in like a larger ramekin, or you could even make a whole big pie out of this if you want to, like all the other pies we've been making today. So I have a pan going. What I wanna get in here is I wanna get in some butter right away. And that's a nice hot pan. Make sure your butter doesn't burn. Then we're gonna add carrot, celery, and onion that have been diced up. So, I'm gonna get this stirring about. And as this cooks, I wanna season as I go. So a little salt, little pepper, and let this just kinda keep coming together. So how I do my chicken pot pies, to make it really simple, is I go to the grocery store and I buy one of those rotisserie chickens. I cool it off completely and I pick it. I pick all the meat off and I separate the bones from the meat. You can shred it or you can dice it up. I'm using just the chicken breast today. You can use the whole chicken depending on how much you're making, how many people you're feeding. So then I take those bones and I make a nice chicken stock. So I take the bones from the roasted chicken, I throw that into a pot. The trimmings from the carrot, celery, and onion go into that pot. A bay leaf, a little bit of thyme, and then just enough water to kind of like let the bones float. And then I cook that for like a couple of hours. And so then I strain it and I have a nice homemade chicken stock. You can also buy chicken broth from the grocery store if you want to too. So to my mirepoix, or my carrot, celery, and onion, what I'm gonna add is I'm gonna add also some sweet corn. So we're making this kind of a California style chicken pot pie. I'm gonna add some bell peppers. And then if I wanted to like kind of take it to another level, I can add like some poblanos, I can add some jalapenos, we could throw in some cilantro, we could throw in, you know, different, you know, types of chilies and stuff like that, and different types of herbs, and just, you know, even like a Mexican spice or a Caribbean spice or something like that, and you can kind of make it your own. So we're just gonna get this all sauteed together. Then what we're gonna do next is we're gonna take a little bit of flour and we're gonna dust the inside of here with flour, creating a roux. And that's probably about 3 or 4 tablespoons. So we're gonna stir that all together, slightly cooking that flour. Once that's done, and we got a few minutes on that, then we're gonna go in with our chicken stock. And you wanna stir as you kinda add this. And we want kind of just enough to kind of get everything nice and moist. You can see here, like it kind of almost represents like a stew, not quite a soup. Then I have a little bit of half and half. Now, on this, we could even make this totally vegetarian, okay? So just some variations on this. We could have used a vegetable stock. You could add some sort of tofu or mushrooms or something like that to it. And then as far as the half and half goes, you could use almond milk. You could use straight regular milk. We're using half and half, or you can go straight cream. So basically with this, I'm adding just enough to kind of turn it white is what I'm doing. And as it thickens and comes to a boil, we can sort of adjust our consistency, so to speak, because we don't want it too thick. We don't want it into a paste. We want it still kind of like a gravy, you know, that's in there with everything. So then we have the other things that we have today to go in here are going to be, we have some peas, we have some parsley, and we have some sage. So we're going in, you know, it's a twist on it with the peppers and the corn, but we're also going with kind of classical herbs, all right? So it's coming up to a boil. Now, the reason why the chicken's not in here is because the chicken's already fully cooked. I don't need to cook it anymore. And actually, I want it cold because after this is cooked, we want to get the filling all the way cooled off. And so it's even nice if maybe the peas are still frozen, because that's going to help cool down your mixture. So now this looks good. And you can see here, it tends to coat the back of a spoon. So if I run my finger through it, it moves real slow down through that portion as to kind of tell you how thick it is. I can let it like cook for a little bit to kind of get that raw flour flavor out of it. But I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna shut it off. I can check it for seasoning, but I'm pretty sure that this is really good. I'm gonna add my chicken. Gonna add my peas. Now I'm adding the peas last. These are frozen peas because they're already cooked too. They've been blanched. And we don't want to overcook any of that stuff. Then I'm gonna add my sage. Add my parsley. And then I'm just gonna give this a nice stir. And you can see how gorgeous that looks. Just absolutely great. With a really nice pie crust on that, it's gonna be great. So, let me get this set aside. Now the reason why it has to be cooled all the way off is if it's not, what's gonna happen is it's just gonna heat up that pie crust that we've been making, and it's just gonna sink right into the dough. It's not gonna get flaky, it's gonna be indented, it's gonna look funny, all that stuff. So we're going to bring over the dishes we're going to serve the pot pie in. And if you want, you can do crust along the bottom too. But we're just going to crust the top, make it nice and easy. You can also buy like puff pastry at the grocery store or something like that. And that makes it real easy. Just cut around and put that on top. Egg wash it and all that. So gonna add the filling. We're gonna add quite a bit of it. So it's like right to the top. Otherwise, our pie crust could still sink in. So we want them nice and full. And then what I do is once both of these are filled up, we're gonna put these in the freezer and we're gonna let them cool off to at least room temperature. And then we'll get our pie dough over the top and we'll keep moving. We'll get them into a 300 degree oven and they're gonna look beautiful and be ready to serve for dinner. All right, we'll see you guys in a few minutes.
For information on sponsorship of GTV programming, call 826-5964.
Okay, so let's finish up our chicken pot pies. So the chicken pot pie filling is at least down to room temperature, if not actually a little bit cold. And so I'm going to set these aside. And I have my dough here. Get some flour down. Flour down on top, and we're just going to roll it out again. This one can be more of a square because I'm going to cut circles out of the dough. Okay, I don't know if you can see this on camera or not, but in the dough itself, you can see little lumps of the butter. And that's what I was talking about earlier. Those little pockets of butter will actually melt away as this dough cooks, and that will leave a little pocket that helps create flaky pie dough. So let me get this rolled out here. Needs a little bit more flour. Like so. We don't want it too thick. Then we're going to take a cutter that's a little bigger than the top of our bowls here. So this is just like a really big biscuit cutter. I'm going to cut two of these just like so. We can utilize this dough for something else. I'll set these aside. This out of the way. Bring these over. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to egg wash the top of the bowl. That way the dough actually seals itself to the top of the dish. Now, sometimes it shrinks on you, so we need to take it and make sure it comes all the way around and it seals nicely right on top, just like that. Do this other one. If you have to, after you cut it out, hit it with the rolling pin one more time. All the way out to the edges. And then I need to grab a knife really fast and we're gonna cut the tops. Let's egg wash them first. And just so you know, the egg wash is basically a whole egg and a little bit of water just to thin it out slightly. Otherwise it tends to feel like you're just sort of spreading egg and moving egg around. Let me grab a paring knife or a knife. And then we're just gonna X the top here. Just like so. That way it has a vent because the steam is gonna come out of there and it's gonna vent one way or another. So I'm gonna get these in the oven and we'll check them out afterwards. They're going to be beautiful and crispy, and we'll be eating chicken pot pie. See you in a minute. Okay, so now our next pie that we're going to do is a version of a classic pecan pie. We're going to do a chocolate pecan pie with a salted caramel sauce. It's absolutely amazing. It's my wife's favorite. So what we're going to start with is We have traditional like dark Karo syrup. And we're gonna be adding all of that in. And I'm just using my whisk to kind of get it out of there. Okay, then gonna go in with vanilla. We're gonna go in with sugar. And then we have 3 eggs. So, gonna bring this together. Gonna start by whisking the 2 sugars together. And then we're gonna add the eggs. Bring that whole mixture together to where the sugar starts to dissolve, nice and dissolved into the eggs. And that's looking really nice to me. You can see it's that beautiful caramel color. All right. So now what I do is I have my chocolate, which I'm using a Ghirardelli chocolate. And it's basically I'm using a milk chocolate and a semi-sweet chocolate. You can use whatever chocolate you want. You can go really dark. You can do different brands. It's really up to you. And then I have my pecan halves. And you can use pieces if you want. They're a little bit cheaper, but you want to toast them. And so I took a sheet pan with some parchment paper and threw the pecans on the parchment paper and into the oven at 350 degrees for right about like 10 minutes. You don't want to burn them. You just want to get them lightly toasted because they're going to toast in the pie once again. So now I'm going to go ahead and get my pie crust. So this is one that we went ahead and we put into the pie dish earlier. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with a layer of chocolate right on the bottom. All across the bottom here. Then I'm going to go in with some pecans. Layer of pecans. And then a little bit more chocolate. Make sure you save some chocolate for the very top. Really important. You want to have chocolate all the way through the thing. Then the last little bit of pecans. And then more chocolate. So to where it's almost full, you can see that there's still plenty of room in there for the filling. Now, it might not take quite all this filling. It all depends on how many nuts, how much chocolate you add. That varies. What you have to be real specific on is the filling itself, the eggs, the sugar, the Karo syrup. Okay? So now we're going to add this in, making sure you don't overflow the pie. And this is a 9-inch pie. Is what this is. So then I'm gonna take my spoon and I'm just gonna make sure I don't have any air bubbles. Okay? And then from here, we'll take the egg wash, we'll egg wash the edges of it, just like we did with our previous pies. We're gonna get it into the oven and this will be your chocolate pecan pie. The final stage to this is the caramel sauce itself. So this is a kind of a tribute to Idna Gardner. This is her salted caramel recipe, which basically you take sugar and water and you're going to bring that to a boil. Once the sugar is completely dissolved into the water, you boil it rapidly till it hits about 350 degrees and turns a caramel color. Then you're gonna add the cream to it. And the cream's gonna, it's gonna all agitate itself and come up. Make sure you're in a big pot so the cream doesn't overflow. And then from there, you just kind of cool it off and it'll thicken as it cools. And this is the consistency that we're looking for. This is gonna go on the pie after the pie's baked. It's a really great combination. And we'll get this into the oven and we'll see you in a minute. We'll start our next pie. The next pie is a mixed berry pie. I've found that you can use just about any berry that you want. You can use fresh berries or you can use frozen berries. But realize that not to have too much liquid. You know, the frozen berries are fine, but if there's extra ice in there, get rid of it. So I use fresh berries today, and I chose a selection of blueberries, raspberries, and blackberries. I love this pie. This is one of my favorites. And it really comes together really interesting, and people always ask me about this pie, and they never knew that one of the major ingredients in it, besides the berries, is tapioca. This is fast cooking tapioca. You can get it in any grocery store. And actually on the box itself, it tells you different fruit pies that you can make with it. Now, if you're not a fan of tapioca pudding, don't worry. You're not gonna have little balls of stuff in here. You're not even gonna be able to tell. It's just used as a thickener. And it works way better than any kind of cornstarch or anything like that. So to the berries themselves, I'm gonna add the tapioca. I'm gonna add the vanilla, and that was about, this is, on the berries, it's 3 boxes of blackberries, 3 boxes of blueberries, and 3 boxes of raspberries. Then we added 10 tablespoons of tapioca. Then I'm gonna go in with, you know, about a teaspoon of vanilla. This is like 2 pinches of salt. And then the sugar, 2 cups of sugar. Now you can vary on the sugar a little bit too, if you want sweet or less sweet. This is actually, believe it or not, gonna be a less sweet pie because the berries are all so tart. Then I'm gonna go in with oranges, and oranges are a Riverside Inland Empire staple. These oranges actually came from my father-in-law's orchard. So my wife grew up in a orange grove, and we go over there and we pick oranges all the time. Meyer lemons and all different types of citrus. So we're gonna add this in, and this is the only liquid that we're adding. The berries themselves are gonna give off a ton of liquid. And so I just get these oranges squeezed in here. If you want to add a little zest, if you want it to be more orangey, you can. If you wanted to even add a little bit of like Grand Marnier, some sort of orange liquor, you can add some of that too. It makes it really good. So 2 full-size oranges, and then I'm going to start stirring. Let me get this stuff all out of the way. The only other thing that I have here that goes into the filling is flex butter. And that's mostly just to help it keep moist. So you can see it's really a dry mixture. Like I said, as this cooks, all these berries are gonna break down. And even if I let this sit for a little while, this would pool up into a liquid. Now that's the thing with this too, is you need to be ready. You gotta have your pie crust into your pie and be ready to roll out your topper when you mix this, which I am ready. All this stuff's in the fridge behind me, because otherwise this will become berry soup, and you won't be able to use near as much of the berries of the liquid itself. So now that that's really well mixed, I'm gonna go ahead and get out my pie crust. Here's the bottom. Here's the top. And so I'm gonna take the berry mix. And remember, don't overfill your pie. So we're gonna take this and we're gonna spoon this into the pie. And you do want as many as you can get in here though. But see how it's nice and evenly coated. There's not like big clumps of tapioca or anything like that. So that's about right. You can see, you know, berries vary, and the baskets will sometimes vary in size. And so that looks good to me. We want to kind of just slightly come up to the rim. We're not overflowing. There's still quite a bit of gaps in here, and it will settle as it cooks. And so we're going to set the rest of those berries off to the side. And then the next thing we're going to do is we're going to add the little flecks of butter. And so just along the top here, my butter's melting a little bit, so it's being a little difficult, but that's okay too. This is just gonna add a little bit of richness to the filling itself. And I think you guys are really gonna like it. So definitely add the butter, don't omit the butter. Now we're gonna deal with our topper. So we have the top of our dough here. We have a little bit of bench flour. We're gonna get this onto our cutting board again. Then onto the top of the dough, get that flattened out. Then we're gonna get this rolled out. Now, nice and round. Same size as the pie itself. Okay, so we can do a couple of things with the lattice crust. And that's what we're doing. We're putting on a lattice crust onto this pie. We can cut strips with a cutter and we can have it waffle or whatever. You can get any kind of cutter you want. And then what you have to do is you put them all on in one direction and then you pull back either one and then you lay a strip across and then you put those over and then you pull back the next one. It's kind of a pain. So what I suggest are the pie toppers. So I have a lattice pie topper that we're gonna be using, but you know, there's trees, there's like kind of like circle cuts or teardrop cuts. There's little apples, whatever you want. There's a bunch of different pie cutters out there. And what this is like a big cookie cutter. And so we're gonna go on here and we're gonna press this down and give this a jiggle. Okay, so this comes off and sometimes they come out and sometimes they don't. And then you just take a paring knife and you go through here and you just pull them out. Now, it is warm in here today. So my dough is quickly getting warm. So I want to work really fast. Okay, now I got almost all of these out of here. I need to bring over my pie. Need to egg wash the edge of it so the two pies' doughs seal together. Really, really important, otherwise you won't get a good seal. And then take this pie dough, roll it up onto the rolling pin, bring my pie forward, and lay the topper on. Now we'll make some adjustments. You can see how that lattice crust still looks really great on there. And that was a lot easier than doing it the old school traditional way. Now, I leave a lot of crust around the rim of this one. This is one of those pies that loves to overflow. And so we want to almost build like a dam around the outside of this pie and make sure that all these pies, the apple, the berry, the pecan, all of these, that we put a sheet pan underneath them. If you don't put a sheet pan underneath the pies and they overflow, it's going to make a huge mess in your kitchen. So now we're going to pinch this together, creating a better seal all the way through. We're going to egg wash it, which I like to have my wife do this part, but I'm going to get it all egg washed and we'll get it into the oven and we'll be right back and we'll show you what this pie looks like. See you in a minute.
Identity theft is one of the most common crimes in the world right now, and it's a big problem for today's shoppers. You use your card a lot, and it's easy for thieves to get that information. So here's a crime tip about debit cards and credit cards. Debit cards are connected to your own bank account, the same bank account that you may use to pay your mortgage, rent, car payment, and utility bill. Your money in the bank. A credit card is the bank's money that they expect to be paid back after you borrow it. It's much better to use your credit card at gas stations and restaurants, as well as for online purchases. These are high-risk locations where your card information could be compromised. Discrepancies on your debit card can take several months for the bank to return your money back to your account. You also have to worry about your mortgage, rent, car payments getting interrupted until your bank corrects the problem. If someone gets your credit card information, it's the bank's money that was stolen, and it's much easier for you to correct. And if you pay off your credit card every month on time, you could avoid those finance charges. If you have any information about someone dealing in stolen credit cards or identity theft in general, call us. Just because they're using a computer instead of a gun doesn't lessen its impact on you. Stay safe.
Okay, so the day's done, and we've made a whole bunch of autumn pies. We have my classic Grandma Sevely's apple pie. We have a chocolate pecan pie, which, you know what? We can't forget the salted caramel sauce, and just drizzle that right over the top of everything and put that onto each slice. Just absolutely delicious. And then we have our mixed berry pie as well, that has the blueberries, the raspberries, and the blackberries. Then we have the chicken pot pie, which is just absolutely gorgeous. So like I do at all my shows, I'm gonna invite my wife, Tara Sevely, up to help me taste one of the chicken pot pies. Here she is, just looking absolutely beautiful. And so I'm gonna dip into here and pull up a little bit of chicken pot pie. And I'm gonna do the same. Oh man.
It's really tasty.
Absolutely delicious. So, this is Chef Robert Sevely and Tara Sevely. Thanks for joining us on Flavor of Riverside. We'll see you next time, and keep cooking.